Hey guys, BigNate84 here, and welcome to the second video in my Live Sound 101 video series. So thank you for joining me again if you're coming back for the next one. And I wanted to bring to your attention, before we get into the lingo and jargon about live sound, I know that YouTube is a worldwide thing. There are many people watching from all over the world, so shout out to my viewers in the UK, Canada, Mexico, Germany, North Korea, not so much. That's a whole other video series. But I did want to bring to your attention, since we're talking about lingo and jargon, maybe English is not your first language. I want you to know that I make captions for all my how-to videos. So you can turn on the captions, you can open up the script and follow along that way. It's just in case it might help you if you're hard of hearing or maybe English is not your first language. So just be aware of that. Captions are available for all of my videos. Now, we're talking about lingo and jargon. But before we get into that, my last video, the introduction, I talked about how it's important for a live sound guy to understand music, maybe be able to read music, and understand basic song structure. So I wanted to give you an example of a real-world situation where that would probably come into play. All right, so it's 7 a.m. You're going off to do live sound at your house of worship, and the soloist comes in. Let's say Eric comes in with a CD, and he says, "You know what? Linda had this whole piece prepared on the piano, and she was going to accompany me. But you know what? Linda got the flu, so she's, you know, she can't make it this morning. But I did bring in this CD. I got this CD here, and it's a split track. And, you know, I'll just do this instead. So here you go. Here's the CD. Oh, and by the way, it's a split track, and I didn't have time to learn the first verse. So when you start it, could you just start it at the first chorus? And then we'll be good to go." All right, now, if you're a live sound guy and you don't have an understanding of music, what I just explained to you, that real-life situation, might throw you off your game. That might be a little bit of a curveball. So first of all, what's a split track? A split track is a type of CD where there's two tracks. I mean, all CDs have two tracks, a left and a right. But this one is not a left and a right track. It's usually a instrumental track and a backup vocal track. And then a singer, a soloist, will sing over those tracks. And maybe they don't want any backup vocals, so you just pull that fader all the way down. And maybe they want a little bit of backup vocal, so you put that one all the way up, but they definitely need the instrumental. So that's a split track. That might be older technology. You might not see that too much anymore, but it's good to know how to handle it if it does come up. Now, the other thing he said, I didn't have time to learn the first verse, but I want to just start right at the first chorus. All right, so to understand music kind of comes into play a little bit, because he's not going to say, "Oh, and by the way, the first chorus starts at 42 seconds into the song," you know. He might say that. And some split tracks are actually broken up into many, many different tracks. You can skip around according to the measures. You know, you can skip to measure 56, measure 34, whatever measure you want, but not all of them are. You know, if they were, then it would be very convenient, because you could say, "Okay, I want to skip to the first chorus. That chorus coincides with the, you know, track number 80. So then you can just start right there." But if that wasn't the case, you would actually have to listen to the song. You have to understand what a verse was, understand when the verse ends, and understand when the chorus begins, and then pause the CD so that you can cue it up with the snap of a finger and start right then and there. So that's a little bit of a real-life example of why it's good for a sound guy to understand the basics of music. All right, now that I've given you my little spiel, let's get into some of the lingo. I just want to give a brief overview, some of the terms that might be thrown at you. Okay, so we talked about split track. Let's talk about a snake. You might hear this term, snake. Basically, a snake is a bundle of individual mic or line level audio cables. So there'll be a thick bundle, sometimes as thick as like a fire hose, and sometimes they're typically, might have an 8 channel snake, a 16 channel, 32 channel, whatever it is, 36 channel, And basically, it is a long cable. You know, in the live sound world, they can be hundreds of pounds and hundreds of feet long. But it's basically how the signal, analog signal, gets from the stage back to the mixer. So that is a snake. Monitors. Monitors are speakers, specifically designed to aid a performer so that the performer can hear themselves on stage, or aid a mix engineer so that they can hear the mix in the control room. So that is monitor. It's just a speaker used to help somebody hear what's going on. Let me take a sip of my floral mug. Cans. You might hear this term. Cans.
It's in my ear.
Headphones. Yeah, I don't know if it came from the broadcast world or what, but that's the lingo to describe headphones. They're commonly referred to as cans. These are some really old ones, by the way. Next, we've got backline. Okay, this is kind of like, you know, if you have a larger scale production, like in my last video when I was talking about doing sound at the Tweeter Center, backline is the amplification for bass players or for guitar players or keyboardists or even drums. It can be considered backline, but it's basically all the equipment that gets lined up in the back behind the artists or performers on stage. That's referred to as backline. Next, let's talk about directional cues. So we've got stage left and stage right. So if I'm standing on stage as a performer looking out into the audience, stage right would be on my right. If I'm standing on stage looking out into the audience, stage left will be on my left. Next, we've got upstage and downstage. Upstage is away from the audience. Downstage is towards the audience. And then we've got house left and house right. So house left is from the audience's perspective. So house right would be from the audience's perspective and to the right. House left from the audience perspective to the left. Front of house, we've talked about this before. That's FOH. You might see that term thrown around. That's front of house. That's typically where the mixer will set up, where the live sound guy will camp out during the performance so that they can hear what's going on right in the middle of the audience to set up a good mix. Line array. So these are speakers that hang from the ceiling, typically. They can also be mounted from the floor, but you'll see these speakers that kind of hang down with like a J curve, right? And there's a very specific distance between each speaker. There's many, 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 many speakers in there, and there's a very specific distance between each one. And what that allows you to do is reject feedback, a term we're going to talk about shortly. And not only that, it rejects feedback, but because of the specific fixed distance between each speaker, you can actually control the beam of sound coming out of there. And there's all kinds of signal processing that goes on ahead of time, and they play with the time differences so that you can actually control the sound. And so that's what a line array is. It's a fancy configuration of speakers. In ears, you might hear this term. That's a short term for in-ear monitors. So you'll see somebody singing the national anthem at the Super Bowl, and they'll be like doing this, and then all of a sudden they'll rip their in-ear monitors out. That's so they can hear what's going on without actually having a speaker set up down, out on the stage in front of them. Handheld. That's a term for a handheld wireless microphone. Lavalier, lav. People say all different things, but a lavalier style microphone is just like one of those little clippy ones that clips on right here. And it's also typically wireless. Doesn't have to be wireless. It could be a lavalier style microphone that is actually hardwired or plugged in, but typically in a house of worship situation, they will be wireless. And that's to pick up a speaker or vocalist. Next we've got phone connector. I've got one back here. Actually, the headphones I just showed you have a phone connector. So that's a phone connector, sometimes called quarter inch and sometimes called TRS for tip, ring, and sleeve. TRS. So this is a type of stereo connector, or it could be a balanced connector. More on that later. And we've got XLR.
Here's an XLR.
Also called barrel connectors. This right here is very common. Very common for microphones to be XLR connectors, but you can also send line level signals this way, or you could send stereo unbalanced signals this way. So that's an XLR. RCA. I'm sure you guys know what RCA is, but just in case, it's an RCA connector. And that's just a double connector. The XLR actually had three conductors. The RCA has two conductors. It's just got the hot and the ground, which is the shield, right? And that you can also send, in addition to audio, video this way. I'm sure you've probably plugged in your TV using RCA connectors. Line that up. 3.5 millimeter. So these are sometimes called stereo mini or 3.5 millimeter jacks. And I've got one right here. It's kind of like a mini quarter inch, right? Hence the name. Also, tip, ring, sleeve. A speak-on connector. I actually don't think I have one of those handy, probably somewhere in the wall behind me. But a speak-on connector is a speaker level connector. So that's high output, high voltage, high current. It's not a low voltage signal. All the connectors I mentioned, well, I guess I can't say that because there are exceptions to every rule. But for the most part, audio coming from the stage, you know, into your console is going to be low voltage. So it's not going to hurt you, you know, nothing's going to happen. But a speaker level is a higher voltage. It's still probably not going to hurt you, but it's not a good idea to like put it in your mouth. Let's see. A yellow jacket. A yellow jacket is one of those floor covers. You know, if there's a high traffic area where a lot of people are walking and you're at a venue, a yellow jacket is one of those things that protects the cables. And it has a cover over it. I'll get a picture and throw it up on the screen for you. But basically protects cables from foot traffic. And they're just often referred to as yellow jackets. Distro. A distro is short for, well, it could be short for all kinds of distribution, but typically in the live sound world, it's power distribution. So at many of the shows I worked at, you will have a big wheel around box, and it handles the three phase power, and it distributes it to all the amplifiers and places where the sound guy needs to have 120 volts AC power. All right, now we've got mixer, right? So you guys know what a mixer is. It's sometimes called a soundboard, sometimes it's called an audio desk, sometimes it's called a console. That is where the live sound guy mixes from, the mixer. Routing all those signals all over the place. All right, guys, thank you for watching this video. I hope you have found it informative, and please stay tuned for the next one.